This panel is going to address the underlying causes of ideological extremism. Each panelist is going to take a kind of a different angle to get at some of this complex question. As I mentioned, we kind of broke this into two parts, and this is the first part. I'm going to introduce the speakers right now and quickly leave the stage. Our first, it's going to provide opening remarks and kind of, again, set the stage for this part of this panel, is Dr. John Alterman. He's a senior vice president and Brzezinski chair in global security and geostrategy, and the director of the Middle East program at the Center for International CSIS. Excuse me. Much easier when you have something in your throat. He received his PhD in history at Harvard and specialized in the Middle East. Prior to joining CSIS in 2002, he served as a member of the policy planning staff at the U.S. Department of State, I'm really having trouble today, and as a special assistant to the Assistant Secretary of State for Near East Affairs. He has published or authored 9 books on the Middle East and travels and lectures frequently all over the world. On a personal note, John may not remember this, but I met him in 2004 when I contacted him to ask him about career options in the middle of a PhD, and I always remember this, and I'm very grateful for the amount of time he spent, and I'll say it had something to do with me being here and trying to play at the intersection of academia and policy. So thank you very much. Our first panelist after John opens up the floor for everybody is Dr. Mia Bloom. She's a professor of communication at Georgia State University, our neighbor right down the road, and she holds a BA in Russian, Islamic, and Middle Eastern Studies from McGill University, an MA in Arab Studies from Georgetown, and a PhD in Political Science from Columbia University. She's an expert on terrorism, specializing in ethnic conflict, rape and war, child soldiers, and a number of other uplifting topics. She has authored a number of books and articles on terrorism that have had a tremendous impact on the field, including Dying to Kill, The Allure of Suicide Terror, Bombshell, Women in Terror, Small Arms, Children in Terror, which is with Don Horrigan.
There's a theme.
And Veiled Threats, Women in Jihad, which is going to be a forthcoming book.
Inshallah.
So Professor Bloom is a former term member of the Council on Foreign Relations and a fellow at the International Center for the Study of Terrorism at Penn State. I could go on with each and every one of the panelists here and the next one, but these are the truncated versions of their CVs, their bios. So Hisham Melham is an analyst for Al Arabiya News Channel based in Washington, and he's based in Washington, D.C., and he writes a weekly column for Al Arabiya in English. He's also a correspondent for An-Nahar, leading Lebanese daily. And Mr. Melham received his BA in philosophy from Villanova in 1976, and he's pursued graduate studies at Georgetown University. Mr. Melham's writings appeared in publications ranging from the Literary Journal of Al-Mawakif in Beirut, LA Times, Huffington Post, Foreign Affairs, Foreign Policy, Politico magazine. He's also interviewed such figures as President Obama, former Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff Mike Mullen, and the Secretaries of State Hillary Clinton and John Kerry, among others. Therefore, if he interviews one of you, also students of the crowd, you might have you might follow in their footsteps, I guess. Dr. Lorenzo Vedino is the director of the Program on Extremism at George Washington University's Center for Cyber and Homeland Security. Vedino earned a law degree from the University of Milan and a doctorate in international relations from Tufts, the Tufts Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. He's held positions at Harvard Belfer Center for Science and International Affairs, at the Kennedy School, the U.S. Institute of Peace, RAND Corporation, and the Center for Security Studies in Zurich. Dr. Vedino is an expert on Islamism in Europe and North America. His research over the past 15 years has focused on the mobilization dynamics of jihadist networks in the West, governmental counter-radicalization policies, and activities of Muslim Brotherhood-inspired organizations in the West. He's the author of several books and numerous articles, and Dr. Vedino's most prominent and famous book is The New Muslim Brotherhood in the West, a book published in 2010 by Columbia, with an Arabic edition released the following year, and it had a big impact on the field. Dr. Vedino has testified before Congress, parliaments, and his commentaries to diverse international and national media outlets. With that, now that I'm out of breath, I want to welcome Dr. John Alterman to the stage and your panelists. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's a great pleasure to be at an event that is part honoring Sam Nunn, somebody who has been a hero of mine since I worked in the Senate 29 years ago and used to see him on the television screen all the time saying smart things. I have a 17-year-old daughter, and as you know, 17-year-old daughters are very hard to impress. And you know, President's King, she doesn't really care, but about a month ago, we were having lunch one weekend, and I mentioned to her that a couple of my students, when I was teaching at Harvard, became writers and producers for the television show Friends. And suddenly her face thought, wow, you know, people who wrote for Friends, it was like this incredible moment. And then on Sunday, I was talking to my wife, and she said, so remind me why you're going to Atlanta? I said, well, I'm speaking at this thing for Senator Nunn. He sent me a personal note. Personal note? He signed it, Sam. And I got the same reaction. My wife was so amazed that I get notes from Sam Nunn that are signed Sam. Suddenly I had credibility that I often lack in most of my life. So there you have it. I'm delighted to be here. I want to talk about how this goes, and I think the way we'll start is by talking about giraffes. This remarkable species, Giraffa camelopardalis. It's a really cool, it's weird, but it's cool, right? They're really tall, and they drink barely at all. And this species, what kind of weird species that when they give birth, the babies drop 5 feet? What kind of species, right? It's kind of weird. And little babies, when they're born, they can run and run. This is an incredible species, this Giraffa camelopardalis. Except apparently, we found out a few weeks ago, there's no such thing as Giraffa camelopardalis. There are actually 4 different species of giraffes. We had no idea. We kept describing them as giraffes. We kept describing them as if they were one thing. But in fact, there were a whole bunch of different things. There were different populations that don't mix at all. We lumped them because it was easier for us to lump them, but in fact, they're different. Okay, I thought we were talking about jihadis. What's giraffes have to do with jihadis? By the way, just to point out, the guy is wearing an ammunition belt for a gun that takes a magazine. So he's not a serious guy. Anyway. What does this mean about jihadis? We know a fair amount about Islamic extremism, right? We know it has become this global phenomenon for 25 years, mostly attracts young folks, right? It has this weird ability to attract a lot of people who don't start off as especially religious. It's kind of strange. We know that it thrives in places where there are conflicts. But there's a lot that we don't quite understand about Islamic extremism, about how it works. How do folks get recruited? Can you identify vulnerable people early and turn them away into a different path? If you were able to intervene early, what would that look like? And we're still trying to figure this out. What motivates folks other than anger? We understand that anger is a part, and General Allen talked some about the sort of the sense of injustice. But at the same time, how do you convince so many people to be willing to kill civilians? How do you convince so many people to kill themselves? It's kind of a basic act that you don't commit suicide, and yet there seem to be lots of people willing to do it. Is this sort of sense of group identity, is that kind of the way nationalism works? Does it work differently from nationalism? We understand a lot about nationalism. Is this a similar phenomenon or a different phenomenon? And here's one of the things that puzzles me. We keep thinking about jihadi organizations as being sort of unified, but jihadi organizations are constantly trying to struggle with difference, right? There are lots of jihadis. Oftentimes, they speak different languages. If you have people going to Syria, they don't all speak Arabic. They don't all speak English. They don't all speak Chinese. You have to deal with the fact that these guys are from all over the world speaking all kinds of different languages. They're from different countries. They come from different traditions. There are some educated people, some very uneducated people. Some of the people have criminal backgrounds. They don't all fit into a cookie cutter mold, and yet somehow jihadi organizations are able to put them together. So as you try to think about how an organization like that works, I think it's useful to think about gangs. We actually understand a fair bit about how gangs work as sort of a sociological phenomenon. There is a socialization process that gets people into gangs, right? There's sort of a membership process. There are lots of rituals and symbols. Is this starting to sound familiar with what we know about jihadis? They punish people if you don't do the right thing. There's this cult of masculinity in gangs that I think we see a lot in jihadi movements. There's accepting violence, especially against outsiders. There is this sense of solidarity, which does lots of things. There's you get protection and livelihood. All those things are things we understand about gangs, might give us some insight into jihadi organizations. Also, what we know about militaries. Militaries do all those things. There are a variety of motivations to join. In some ways, militaries are more like jihadi movements, right? And there are a wide range of skill levels and talents. Everybody in the military knows you have to find a way to use people who have high-order skills and low-order skills. So I was talking to a big city police chief as part of a project we're doing at CSIS in June about, he was talking, he had a lot of success with gangs. I said, so what have you learned from your experience working with gangs that helps you on this jihadi problem? And what he said was, we used a lot of what we learned about gangs to deal with radical groups, but the groups are much more complicated. So even as complicated as the sort of sociology of gang membership is, there's a whole sociology of militaries as well, the jihadi stuff is even more complicated. So if you think about complicated things and you're coming down to Atlanta, what do you think about? You think about CDC and infectious disease, right? How does infectious, that's the smallpox virus. How does infectious disease work? It's this complex system. It can be transmitted quickly, like jihadi ideology. It often follows different vectors. You don't have to have intense contact. It is self-replicating. It preys on weak and vulnerable individuals. It is adaptive. You don't have to be successful 100% of the time. You don't have to be successful 50% of the time. You can be successful 3% of the time and create an epidemic. And you can survive even if measures to contain it are 99% effective. How do you eradicate things like that? It's robust. How do you eradicate? We still have Legionnaire's disease outbreaks periodically. It's a hard problem. Think about another hard problem, traffic safety. Traffic safety is big. Lots of people die every year. A heck of a lot more people die every year in traffic accidents than from terrorism. But how do you deal with traffic safety? Suddenly you have all these different parts. There's partly building cars differently. Anti-lock brakes, airbags, safety belts, all those things, unibody construction. You design roads differently. You can alter speed limits. You can change the driving age. You can change your substance abuse laws. You can do more law enforcement. But it seems to me that the big question you have to ask, the hardest question, is what does success look like in traffic safety? What's success look like? How many is enough? How many is too much? What are you really trying to do? Lots of different pieces to the problem. You never have 100% safe cars. Is that okay? How much is okay? How much are you going to try to work to change that? So where does that leave us? I think for us, we still have a tendency to see terrorism as a single organism. We see it as a thing. It's the guys with beards, it's the guys with the guns, with the stupid, you know, bandoliers around their necks. We keep seeing this as a thing instead of as a very complex phenomenon with lots of pieces that has multiple paths of transmission, that is able to compensate for its inadequacies, and has a propensity for self-preservation. It is so much like a disease in those ways. It adapts and morphs to survive. We need, I think, to be much more creative and aggressive seeing how it relates to other phenomena we understand. And I've given you some ideas to start that thinking. We have to define success a lot more thoughtfully than we do. Their whole model is based on low probability, high impact events. Low probability, high impact events. If 10% of their efforts succeed, who's winning? Arguably, they are, right? I mean, the common parlance, they are. But we just had a guy in New York last weekend, right, who tried to set off a whole set of bombs, wasn't able to kill anybody, and was apprehended within 24 hours, and was a lone wolf. Is that a success or a failure? I think we have to, as a country, think through what are we trying to do and what represents success. They have very low bars for success because it's a heck of a lot easier to create disorder than order. We have to wrap our heads around that. To fight this successfully, it seems to me, first, we keep falling back on messaging. People love to talk about words. I have a pet theory about why people love to talk about words, because you can sit in an office in Washington and crank out words, right? It is easy to sit and crank out words from your desk and talk about how we're fighting a war of ideas. I think messaging is a small part of a very complex phenomenon, and I think we can't make it a big part because it's the easiest part. It's like the story of the guy, the drunk guy looking for his keys under a street lamp. And somebody says, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm looking for my keys." And I said, "Well, is this where you lost them?" He said, "No, I lost them over there." He said, "Well, why aren't you looking over there?" I said, "Because this is where the light is." Right? We can't do that. We can't afford to do it. I think we have to right-size our goals and expectations. We can't fall into the traps of making people we need as our allies into our enemies. We can't do it, because that's what they want to do. They want us. They want to create the enmity. They want to create the distance. They want to split populations away from us and toward them. We have to consider the variety of what we're facing. This is a diverse, dynamic phenomenon. There is no essential nature to terrorism, in my judgment, or in this kind of terrorism, this Islamic extremism. There's no single driver. And I think, very importantly, differences we might not be paying attention to provide important opportunities for us to disrupt the way these groups operate. Remember the giraffes? The giraffe started as a horse. And over time, with longer and longer necks, they got more and more advantages, and they adapted to the constraints in their environment. And it seems to me that as we think about combating terrorism, we have to think about what kinds of incentives and punishments do we want to create to have these organizations and the people attracted to them move in directions that we feel are more constructive, more secure for us and their societies than the paths of violence that they're pursuing today. Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much for coming this morning. And I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do. Do I do this? Okay, they'll figure it out. I want to wish everyone a happy morning. Assalamu alaikum. I'm going to talk to you today a little bit about children and ISIS. Dr. John Horgan and I have been working on this project now for about 2.5-3 years. And part of it is to explain the socialization process that Mr. Alterman just laid out to you, that the socialization process for children in violent extremist organizations borrows heavily from some of the existing templates we have from gangs, from cults and from child soldiers, but where it differs is where we find it especially interesting. The research is sponsored by the Department of Defense Minerva Research Initiative. I always have to say that, and then I have to give you the disclaimer that any mistakes are my own, and I do not represent either the US government or the military. So ISIS is building an army of children, as we've seen in a lot of the propaganda videos. This actually was a screenshot that John found in Think Again, Turn Away. So the JMCC, which is now the Global Engagement Center, was trying to show how ISIS exploits children. And one of the things that we've discovered is that there's two kinds of children that they're using. There are the children in the videos, and then there's the children that they're actually using. And let me explain some of the differences. What we tried to do in the project was, can we find, because we had done, based on ISIS's bragging of its child martyrs, and these were kids who had either been suicide bombers or in Gamasi had gone on these high-risk missions, could we find any of the kids in the videos among our, in the first year we found 89, we now have over 140. As we've continued the research. And what's really shocking, and John likes to call this the bottom line up front, the bluff, every single group in Syria is using children, including the ones that are US proxies, including the ones that we think are good guys, and ISIS isn't even the group that's using the most. But I will talk to you about that a little bit more in a second. Could we find any of these children? And in fact, we could not. Instead, what we did was we found children who were used in propaganda over and over again. And as you can see, we have the life of a shibel, where we have this one child in 2013. He's in the background. He's holding a gun, but he's with his dad. In 2014, he's wearing a uniform. He's got the gun. And in 2015, he's the one who allegedly shot two Russian FSB spies in the head. Now, where are we getting some of our material? We get a lot of it on Telegram. And so this is something that the general was talking about, these platforms where you can see what ISIS is saying. And I'll tell you one thing that really took me by surprise and made me chuckle. In August, ISIS endorsed Donald Trump for president, so ISIS loves Trump, and we have all of the propaganda images, and this is really horrifying because you look at this and you think, they want to impact our election. They want to have a say in the election, because what they want to do is exactly what Ambassador Alterman just said, which is drive a wedge, make Muslims in America not feel American. And that's part of the problem, because I can also tell you that the vast majority of things that have been prevented is because of either the Muslim community calling the police or calling the feds, or in just recently with Rahami, a Muslim across the way who called the police and said, the guy that's in the, you know, for wanted FBI in the bolo, he's asleep in the doorway. So we saw this with the underwear bomber. We saw this with the Times Square bomber. We see this time and time again. I just sort of wanted to, in addition to talking about children, just mention Muslim community has been our most important asset in preventing the kinds of attacks that we see in Europe and France from happening here. All right, we did a study of the first year based on Telegram and how ISIS brags about using kids for the CTC Sentinel at West Point. What we found is that children play a variety of roles. Now, some of these roles are in support roles, which is what we expected, having looked at children going all the way back to the American War of Independence. So in other words, the presence of children in militaries is not something that was immediately emerged in the 90s in Africa. This has actually been something that has happened for a very long time. All the way to looking at children in these combat roles. These are the children, the Ingamasi, the Murabit, the children who are suicide bombers, who are on the front lines. We see that the kids are present when ISIS engages in its most horrific acts of violence, like beheadings, as well as the presence of children who are recruiters. Because what ISIS does, and this goes back to this concept of manliness, they try to make people feel unmanly. If you let the kids fight for you, what does it say about your manliness? And it's the same thing Al-Qaeda used to do with women. If you're hiding behind your women, you're letting these women fight for you, you're not murwa, you're not manly. We most recently, about a week and a half ago, see not just on the Dawa caravans, like this young boy, but also now even from the pulpit. We have the presence of children trying to persuade the adults that they need to step up and they need to do something. They need to defend the Khilafah. Now the children are making munitions, and they are Ingamasi. And the Ingamasi, which started around December of 2015, are these high-risk missions in which you have children mixed in with adults. So some of the important differences that we're seeing, the innovations that ISIS is bringing to the table, have to be, for example, in Mozambique, Sierra Leone, DRC, there would have been dedicated children's units. The Sri Lankans and the LTTE in Sri Lanka uses Bakuts, which is a dedicated child unit. Instead, what ISIS is doing is they're mixing adults in with the children. And one of the things that we are interrogating in the data, do they send the kids in first just to be for, you know, shock value? Because you just need to hesitate for a second and then the adults come in behind them. Or do the kids come in first because then the adults behind them won't change their mind? So we're trying to get at not just the fact that the children are mixed in, for example, in this image, but are they used in a way to psychologically impact the enemy or the warfighters? Now, there is a huge contrast between the children who are in the propaganda and the children on the front lines, as I started with. You'll see in the video, this one here, this side here is from a video that was released in May called 100%, which if you say it really fast in French means 100%, but it also means blood for blood. And as compared to the reality of children, where they're mixed in with the adults, they're behind them. What we see in the videos is a lot of the foreign fighter children, they're diverse, they're clean, they're attractive, they are fully equipped, they've got weapons and uniforms, pristine, versus the reality of the children's engagement, where disproportionately the numbers are overwhelmingly Syrian and Iraqi kids who are dying, although sometimes what ISIS does is they send the Syrian kids to Iraq and the Iraqi kids to Syria. So they're away from their families, especially their mothers. They can't change their minds at the last minute. And where are they going to go if they try to run away? So these are all the psychological manipulations that we've been able to observe. But the same kids that were in 100% in May were, in August 26, the five kids who we saw executing the Kurdish prisoners. And so, although ISIS has officially in the past told Vice News, you know, we only train them at 15, there's no one under 15, we know, for example, that one of the boys here, where is he? Jojo is here. That is Sally Jones's son. Sally Jones is the ex-punk rocker who married Junaid Hussein and went to Raqqa with her then 10-year-old son about 3 years ago. Jojo's 13. So they have very, very young kids engaged in acts of brutality, whether it's assassinating what they call spies, or whether it's handing a four-year-old a remote and telling him to press the button, as Issa Dare had to do a few months ago, blowing up a car with three people in. So one of the things that we're trying to grapple with is not only charting these brutalities that ISIS is engaged in, the despicable use of children as frontline actors, but also what are going to be the long-term effects on children who have witnessed violence as well as the children who have participated in it. Now, this is what I started with and I wanted you to see for yourselves. Every single group in ISIS every single group in Syria is using children. And in fact, if you went to look at ISIS, ISIS is blue here. That's blue. Versus, let's see, FSA is red. And the other blue is the total. Free Syrian Army uses 3 times more children than ISIS. They just brag about them less. And so part of what we have to be sensitive to is we are in a very tough situation outside of Syria, trying to figure out if there's any good guys in the country with whom to ally and partner with, because otherwise it's just a cauldron of mess. I'm going to stop here. Thank you so much and for such a depressing topic.
No visuals, and first I'd like to thank Larry and Senator Nunn, a man I admired a lot when I covered him in the 1980s and 90s when there were few senators like him who made us proud of that great institution. I wish we can clone you, Senator. How does it end? And if it is ever going to end, it will probably end with a whimper and not with a bang. And they give you 10 minutes to explain, to provide a guide to the perplexed. But I'll try my best. I was asked by the powers that be to say something about my personal experience growing up in Beirut, witnessing the 67 defeat and the rise of the Islamists and the defeat of the other isms and the death of cosmopolitanism in the Arab world. I will say that, I hope, and but first I need to clarify or say something that I feel very strongly about, and I was not planning to say it, but given the exchange between General Allen and the gentleman there about the role of Muslims in dealing with these problems in their midst, and give me your indulgence because this is some very sensitive and I need to read it. We should keep in mind that the Islamic State is the last of a long string of radical millennial apocalyptic revivalist and schismatic movements led by false prophets, fake caliphs, and usurping Mahdis. The history of Islam is full of fake pretend Mahdis and caliphs. In fact, the dawn of Islam saw the birth of the first such bloody movement, the so-called Kharijite or the Khawarij, literally the outsiders. This was a rebellious movement that practiced a primitive form of egalitarianism and became infamous when one of its adherents assassinated in the year 661 AD the venerable Imam Ali, the son of Hussein, the prince of the martyrs for the Shia. Some of these claimants to prophethood don't deserve more than a footnote. Although the most important classical poet in Arab literature is named Abu Tayyib al-Mutanabbi. And as his name tells you, he was a claimant of prophethood in his youth. Luckily, he saw the light and he dropped that prophethood and he wrote great poetry. We have a forerunner of ISIS. In the 1880s in the Sudan, a man claimed to be the Mahdi. And his name is Muhammad Ahmad ibn Abdullah. He created what we call today the Mahdiya state, which lasted for 20 years and controlled large swaths of Sudan, Egypt, and Ethiopia. And it terrorized the people on the Nile Valley, waged a campaign against the Christians in Ethiopia. They did some of the things that ISIS has been doing to the Yazidis and Assyrians and Christians and whatnot. And he was the guided one. He was the Mahdi. And he was defeated 20 years later. He died, and then he was succeeded by Abdullah ibn Muhammad. He's famous, or they are famous for killing defamed British general Gordon Basha. Later on, he was defeated 20 years later by a combined forces of an expeditionary British force led by another famed British general, Horatio Kitchener, along with 17,000 Sudanese and Egyptians, and they defeated the Mahdiya movement in the famous battle of Omdurman. I mean, when you read the history of that movement, and then you think of ISIS, the similarities are incredible. So our friend Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who is somewhere ensconced in Raqqa or Mosul, is the last of a long string of fake prophets and radical millennial movements in Islam. In fact, every time you see the rise of a Muslim city or a region, take for instance Cordoba in the 12th century. Cordoba in the 12th century was the most cultured, enlightened city in Europe. And of course, it was ruled by Muslims, Arabs and Berber. It was sacked not by, not through the process of Reconquista by the Spaniards, by the Christians, the Catholic Church, or whatever, but by fellow Muslims who came from North Africa. And because they saw Cordoba as too worldly, too materialistic, too sophisticated for their puritanical, primitive understanding of Islam. So here we have a primitive group of Islamists, call them the Khawarij, call them the Wahhabis, call them the Taliban, call them ISIS, destroying a jewel of a cultured city, a Muslim city. And we have to keep that in mind. In fact, in 1979, we had a claimant to prophethood. And he was killed during the siege of Mecca, the great siege of Mecca, when 300 radicals occupied that holy mosque. So we have a long history of this. One final thing, I think I'm going to miss my time. In the current debate among scholars, historians, and journalists about the nature of ISIS, its progeny, and Islamic bona fide, there are those who deny, in the face of tremendous evidence, that ISIS is rooted in Islamic traditions, or that the new hordes of the pretend caliphate have hijacked a peaceful religion, quote unquote, and distorted its humane message. And let me be frank and blunt. None of the three monotheistic religions can be described as only peaceful. In Islam, as in Judaism, there are sacred texts that are anything but peaceful. Next to some of the wonderfully humane, peaceful, and aesthetically gripping passages. But religions cannot and should not be interpreted only solely by the religious or the sacred text. There is the lived history of the community of believers, how the custodians of the faith interpret, defend, exploit, or abuse the sacred text throughout history. The same text can be susceptible to multiple interpretations depending on the interpreter and his time or her time and the sensibilities of their period. The Old Testament and the Quran are, inter alia, chronicles of the lives of various peoples, tribes, men, women experiencing war, peace, love, and hate, redemption, and revenge in concrete historical settings. In these holy texts, poetry and wisdom are found next to passages about chopping off heads and wiping out one's enemies. The Crusaders, who slaughtered their way to Jerusalem in the year 1099, dispatched many Muslims and Jews and enslaved others, were as Christians as the Christians of the Renaissance or today. The Islamic State of today is as Islamic as when Damascus, Baghdad, Cairo, and Cordoba were centers of learning and high culture. Those in academe who absolve Arabs and Muslims of their human agency, who claim that the tragic conditions in many Muslim majority societies are the sins of outsiders, are as pernicious and deceptive as those spewing virulent Islamophobia. It is still impossible for historians and scholars in many Muslim countries to publish objective or critical studies about Islam, its sacred text, and its prophet as historical subjects. There is no way for any Muslim living in a majority Muslim state today, some people may not like this, who can examine critically how the Quran and the Hadith have been compiled, or how to explain the jarring contradictions in the sacred texts, or how Muhammad lived his life and managed his own personal affairs, or how he related to the early Muslims and Christians and Jews of his time. We are still waiting for that Muslim scholar living in a Muslim country to write the definitive biography of the Prophet of Islam that would treat him as a historical figure, fairly and objectively, as a man of genius, foresight, and compassion, who also struggled with his own flaws, foibles, and prejudices, a multidimensional man, and a leader without the apologies. It is high time for Arabs and Muslims to admit that ISIS has deep roots in Islamic traditions, that their recent false Mahdis and caliphs are the latest in a long genealogy, and that ISIS is the latest malignancy among many that their ailing body politics has spawned. I ran out of time. Thank you. I can tell you about Beirut later on if you want.
Thank you very much, Senator Nunn. Real pleasure to be here in front of you. Larry, thank you for the invitation. I do not have a fancy PowerPoint like the first two speakers. I'm going to compensate with what is known as the Italian PowerPoint, which is just excessive hand gestures. So I hope you can bear with me. I run a small center that looks at mostly at jihadist extremism, for lack of a better term, in the West. And I think, obviously, I have a small vantage point because we look at just one part of the world where that phenomenon manifests itself. But the dynamics are very different from the dynamics that we see in the Middle East or in other parts of the world. And a lot of the assumptions, a lot of the analysis that we take for granted for other parts of the world do not really apply to the West, to what we see in the West. I guess my interest goes back to 9/11. One of the things that struck me right after 9/11, once we started to know more about the plotters, about the pilots, the hijackers, was that the core hijackers, the pilots actually, were not the products of slums, were not people who had gone to madrasas or were illiterate. They were actually the products of some of the wealthiest families of Egypt, of Lebanon, of the United Arab Emirates. And they had come to the West, specifically to Hamburg, Germany, to go to graduate school. And what happened, and the second thing that really struck me, was that they actually radicalized in Germany. They did not radicalize in Beirut. They did not radicalize in Cairo. Their radicalization process took place in Germany. So it's an interesting phenomenon what we see in the West, because a lot of the analysis that applies to the Middle East doesn't really work here. And that tells us that radicalization is a very complex and highly individualized process that cannot be, and this has been said earlier, it cannot be one analysis. There is not one single reason. It's often a combination of factors that leads people to radicalize. One thing we look a lot is sort of the comparison between the United States and Europe. What we have seen over the last couple of years in particular, the growth of the radicalization problem. If I had been standing before you 5 years ago, I, as most other people, would have said that radicalization was on the decline. And I think killing of Bin Laden, the beginning of the Arab Spring, which at the beginning saw all of us being optimistic about the outcome, and basically sort of a plateau of attacks and cases throughout Europe or North America, would have led us to think that the phenomenon was under control, if not on the decline. What we have seen, particularly with the war in Syria, is obviously very different. And what we see now is unprecedented. The numbers are not always perfect, but they are one of the best ways to give an idea of how unprecedented what we're seeing is. Europeans talk about 6,000 to 8,000 Europeans who have gone to Syria and Iraq to fight as foreign fighters. That's a huge number. The American numbers are much smaller. We're talking about 200 individuals, more or less. And obviously, as we all know, we've seen a lot of attacks taking place on both sides of the Atlantic. Whether they are structured, organized, like the Paris attacks carried out by cells dispatched by ISIS, or carried out by individuals who have no affiliation whatsoever with any movement, but they are inspired by jihadist ideology in general and take it upon themselves to carry out attacks. It's become sort of a weekly routine, particularly in a country like France. The analysis that has always struck me, as in having lived and worked in both continents for a long time, is the mantra has always been that Europe sees a much larger problem because it has a problem integrating its Muslim population. There's poor socioeconomic integration. It is undeniable, and as a European who holds an American passport, I'm pretty open about it, that if you're not white and Christian, it's a bit difficult to be seen by most people in Europe as a true European. It's different maybe in countries like the UK and the Netherlands, but it's undeniable that America is a much more accepting culture and society. And it's also true that American Muslims fare much, much better than European Muslim communities when it comes to socioeconomic integration. Completely different demographics, completely different communities. Having said that, I think that analysis basically sees almost a mathematic equation. Lack of integration equals radicalization. Good integration equals lack of radicalization. I think it's flawed. It's not completely off. It's a factor that should be looked at, but it's simplistic. And let me just pierce some holes into that whole theory. We've seen quite a few cases of radicalization in the States. We've seen 105 people who have been charged over the last year and a half for ISIS-related activities, and we have seen attacks. We've seen quite a few. We've seen San Bernardino, we've seen Orlando, we've seen New York over the weekend. If you look, and let's just look at the tip of the iceberg, let's just look at the perpetrators of the attacks. Let's just look at San Bernardino, Orlando, and New York. All three individuals were, by the standards which we would normally use to evaluate integration, success stories. They had gone to universities, they had a good job, they had stable family lives. Obviously, at a psychological level, they did not feel like they fit into American society. But from a socioeconomic point of view, success stories. So that's obviously, and if we look at the demographics, if we look at the individuals who have been inspired by ISIS and other groups in the United States, there's absolutely no common profile. We have all kinds of people, but the vast majority of them are quite well integrated. They're mostly as a second, if not third generation. We have, for example, a large number of converts. 30 to 35% of them are actually converts. There's not an issue of integration there when you have converts. So it's a more complex picture. But if we look at Europe itself, again, it's not just a matter of integration. Not all European countries are contributing foreign fighters with the same size, with the same intensity. Countries like Spain and Italy, for example, have contributed a very small number of foreign fighters. We're talking about 100 each. You look at Sweden, for example, as 200. You look at Belgium, 600, smaller countries. And those are countries, or Northern European countries, that actually have a much better they do a much better job at integrating their migrants. There's no surprise that refugees or aspiring refugees that come to the shores of Italy or Spain or Greece do not want to stay with us in the South Mediterranean. We want to go up north because life is much better there. Nonetheless, radicalization is more of a problem in Central and Northern European countries than in the South. Everybody's been talking about Belgium over the last year or so because the cell that carried out the attacks in both Paris and Brussels was largely a Belgian cell, radicalized and formed and radicalized in Brussels and the suburbs of Brussels. Belgium has provided a disproportionate number of foreign fighters. So we're talking about 600 for a relatively small country. If we then look a bit at the dynamics in Belgium, they're a bit peculiar because the distribution of foreign fighters within Belgian territory is not even. You will find that in town A, and there's a small town which has become very famous in sort of counterterrorism circles, it's Vilvoorde, it's a town of 40,000 people, there's been 60 foreign fighters coming from that small town. 40,000 people, whole population, 60 foreign fighters. You go one town over, zero foreign fighters. Same Muslim population in terms of size, same problems of integration, zero foreign fighters. So if integration is bad, is the reason for all this, why is it that town A produces 60 and town B, just 20 miles down the road, with the same integration issues, produces zero? There must be something else. We're talking a lot about the internet as one of the causes of radicalization. And it's undeniable that how ISIS uses the internet and social media in particular has played a major role in radicalizing people. But again, the internet is available to everybody in the same way. Why is it that town A produces 60 people and town B doesn't? It's not that town A has a better broadband connection than town B. Everybody has access to the internet in the same way. If we then even look at Molenbeek, the neighborhood in Brussels, which has become famous for having produced the cell that carried out the attacks, which has been described as a hotbed of radicalization, issues of integration, it is to some degree true. But if you look at it, Molenbeek has a large Muslim population, which is basically 50% Turkish, 50% Moroccan. Of the 50-odd foreign fighters that have gone to Syria, only one of them is from Molenbeek. Only one of them is of Turkish background. All the others are of Moroccan background. except one, actually, that's a good case for Mia, because it's somebody that followed his girlfriend, who was Moroccan. So the only Turkish guy that followed his girlfriend was Moroccan there. So it's a bit of a different story. So what it must be, it's not a matter of Molenbeek as a neighborhood, but there's something about a specific community. And again, not singling out the Moroccan population there, because in other parts of Europe, the Moroccan Muslim population has seen no problems whatsoever. What I'm trying to say here is that radicalization is a very complex process, and there are different levels of analysis. The socioeconomic analysis is crucially important. Fixing some of the issues of poverty and governance in the Middle East, in North Africa, exactly like some of the integration issues that exist in Europe, crucially important. But I think it's important to look at the two levels of analysis. One is the psychological one. Again, that goes hand in hand, complements the other level of analysis by why are certain people subjected to the same conditions as others, interested in a certain ideology, and why others are not. And the third level, it's more of a level of, I don't really have a good word for it, but it's about who you know. It's about being connected to, say, certain networks. The reason why certain towns, and in 10 seconds when I have left, I'm going to explain it, is that what we see is that people who radicalize do not radicalize independently. They mobilize because they know somebody who is radicalized, because they have a friend who is already in Syria or who is in a certain mosque or anyways has connections to the right people. So there are nodes, whether they're online or offline, and those nodes are the ones that really determine the radicalization of a certain individual and of a certain community. I try to bring some complexity to what is already a very complex issue. I hope I didn't confuse you too much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much to our panelists for really stimulating discussion and put out in front of you a lot of really interesting ideas. I'm going to open the floor now for questions. Again, I can also get the questions online, send them to me that way, and be as clear as possible. And we do ask the questions here, try to make them as short and concise and clear as possible so that we can get to as many as we can. We're running a little bit late, but I'm going to extend some of the time from this session to see how it goes. Thank you. You can also welcome to direct some questions, or we might open in some cases up to the rest of the panel. Yes, sir. Oh, wait, one second, wait for the mic.
Thank you. So my question is for Dr. Vidino. So you said that when you look at integration based on things like education and socioeconomic status, you don't find that relationship between integration and radicalization. So my question is, if you looked at integration by looking at the attitudes that the person has towards their host culture, towards the Western culture, their feelings of membership as a European or American, do you think that you would find that relationship?
Yeah, my point in general is that I think we tend to focus a lot, and I understand in a Middle Eastern setting, issues of economy, lack of perspectives, lack of opportunities is crucially important. But generally, when it comes to the West, it's really not that much a matter of people not having opportunities. It's undeniable that certain communities are underprivileged. And even in the United States, there's a reason why Minneapolis has become, by relative standards of the low levels of radicalization we see in the States, why the Somali community there has produced a relatively high number of people who are radicalized. So what I'm saying is it is one of the factors that needs to be taken into consideration. But the more we see, and it's not anecdotal, but we see countless examples of people, I would say the majority, who are relatively well integrated with opportunities and so on, yet gone and radicalized. What I'm suggesting is a more complex, more nuanced analysis that takes into consideration these different approaches. You're absolutely right that it has to do with more integration from a personal point of view, how you feel. Do you feel that you belong into a society? And that, I think, to me explains why a lot of converts, a disproportionate number of converts, become radicalized. And I think these are mostly people who don't really convert to Islam. They convert to ISIS. They convert into whatever form, whatever ideology that is a safety valve, whatever is a way that allows them to express their frustration at society, their anger, whether they have mental issues or not. I think what a lot of the converts we have seen engaged in radical activities over the last few years, probably 40 years ago, would have become left-wing or right-wing militants. Today, what is the strongest anti-society message? It's ISIS more than communism or fascism, which are a bit passé, démodé. So it's a matter of feeling and belonging. I think it's more than that. I think we sometimes overemphasize the economic aspect, particularly in the West.
Larry, can I just add something to Wojciech's question? I think we have to understand that, first of all, there's three things going on. There are different cycles of recruitment, where sometimes ISIS, especially during its period of territorial expansion, was going after particular kinds of recruits. And this is where they were emptying the jails, going after ex-gang members, going after what Risa Brooks and Dan Byman would call low-hanging fruit. And there you do have the interplay between a lack of education, lack of opportunities, criminal background, and ignorance of the faith. But then there are other periods of time where they're going after high achievers. And this is where I'm going to disagree with Dr. Vidinho, that among the Somalis who disappeared in 2007, one boy had just got into Harvard. So there's no lack of opportunities even among the Somali community that went to Al-Shabaab. And I think we want to maybe problematize this a little bit. Most American Muslims disproportionately do better than European Muslims, have higher GNPs, higher levels of education, are better integrated, but that has to do as much with the American understanding of us being a melting pot versus having the almost ghettoized situation as you have in France or, you know, with the banlieue in Paris or Molenbeek in Belgium or other places. And, of course, you know, just not to quote what's been said on the political trail, but the only Americans in this country whose families didn't come from somewhere else are Native Americans. Every single person's father, grandfather, great-grandfather came from Ireland or Germany or Poland. So, I mean, I think we want to understand the reason why we see different messages is that Islamophobia might resonate with someone in France, but the person who leaves Tunisia isn't leaving because they experienced Islamophobia. So there's different scenarios and different kinds of messages targeted for each kind of recruit.
And none of this is math, right? And math doesn't really help you, right? So you can't say, you know, if somebody gets 30% rejection or 20%, so, I mean, it's about percentages of populations. And what I think is hidden in some of Mia's more subtle statistics is very low success rates actually represent huge successes. Right, if you can attract a tenth of 1% of a target population, that's often enough.
Let me get another question back there in the middle. Sorry, I'll get you the next one. Up there, one to the right. Yeah.
Hi, Chelsea Damon, Georgia State University's Transcultural and Conflict Violence Initiative. So this question is for pretty much anyone on the panel who wants to answer it. So we're looking at extremism, and one idea, and Dr. Vidinho touched on it a bit, was, okay, we're going to use the term lone wolf because that's the common term used, but the radicalization process between that versus a group radicalization, individuals that know friends and they go to Syria or Iraq in a group, or that radicalization via association, let's put it that way. But we're seeing a number of attacks by lone wolf individuals that maybe have become radicalized in different ways. However, we're seeing ISIS taking them on as their own, which I feel like is slightly problematic because these are not hardcore radicalized individuals that have been following ISIS for years, have gone over there. They're sort of fledglings, I guess you could say. So all I would like for someone to answer is, what's this difference between ISIS taking associations with attacks for individuals that potentially are not that strongly associated with ISIS?
Whoever would like to answer. Oh, go ahead, John.
I think the way I see a lot of the lone wolf attacks is partly it seems to me to be driven by suicidal individuals, right? And this falls into the, you know, in different ages they would have gone in different directions. But it seems to me that some of this is frankly just suicide driven by anger, despair, depression, whatever. And the other thing, and this is probably quite controversial, but I still think it's true. I think for a lot of people, there's like, they get enough Islam out of it to make them feel okay about it. And for a lot of people, I mean, strangely, a lot of people who kill in the name of Islam are not very religious, right? There's that guy, it was at Chattanooga, the Naval Recruiting Station, who was having drug problems and family problems, and he basically decided, you know, what in other situations is known as suicide by cop, but he decided that it would be actually better if it had, like, enough Islamic legitimation to not represent a suicide. And I think, I mean, Will McCants actually left. I don't know where he is. But you should ask him when he comes back. I think there are different levels of religious legitimation that people need. And for a lot of people, especially in the lone wolf category, a lot of them aren't especially religious, aren't especially knowledgeable, but there is enough of a religious veneer to justify. And it's actually justifying something they want to do for totally non-religious reasons. And it's, you know, again, it's easy to lump it all into one phenomenon. I think there are actually lots of really different things going on.
I might add one little thing. I think, you know, we see a lot of different cases. Each one should be analyzed individually, but a lot of cases that are often called lone wolves are really not. Most people radicalized in groups, small groups of people. Not always the case. You're always going to find outliers. You're always going to find people who have completely radicalized independently online, never met a like-minded individual in the physical space. But what we often see is attacks carried out by one individual, but maybe not receiving any kind of material operational support of that attack, but they were part of a group of individuals who espoused the same ideology. And I think you can apply that analysis to some cases here in the States, like San Bernardino, or to some of the most recent cases in Europe, like Nice. Radicalization tends to be a group process. Again, always an exception. And ISIS is very good at, for example, reaching out to vulnerable people online the same way pedophiles do. The grooming process is almost identical. So they will find lonely, vulnerable people. But generally speaking, radicalization happens in groups.
Okay, great. I'm gonna come back to you, sir, in a second. I have a lot of questions here. But I actually want to follow up with Hisham. He kind of tempted us a little bit and said he would talk about how he compares from his growing up in Beirut background and seeing how ideological extremism compares with that versus what we see today and some of the main characteristics. So.
Well, I grew up in a very liberal city, open city, where the United States has a tremendous cultural influence. You could see a play by Shakespeare at the American University, a play by Molière at the French University, and Arabic plays everywhere. This is the late 60s, early 70s. The ideologies were not Islamist. In fact, we used to make fun of the Islamists. Most of us, you know, would take pride in the fact that we, you know, we are secularist or Arab nationalist or whatever. And Beirut was, along with Alexandria, the two greatest Eastern metropolitan, cosmopolitan centers. Then, with the advent of the military rulers, this inheritance of openness and liberalism began to crumble. And then the biggest blow was the 67 defeat, in which it was seen as a defeat of Arab nationalism, of secularism, of socialism, you name it, all of these isms. And then the Islamists on the Sunni side began to reassert themselves after they were crushed in the 1950s and 60s by these officers and Arab nationalism. And then they began to tell us that Islam, al-Islam huwa al-hal, Islam is the solution. In my days, anti-Americanism was political. People like me were, definitely me, we were infatuated with America's popular culture. American cinema, American music, blues, jazz, rock and roll, John Wayne, you name it. And so you couldn't hate the United States. You would hate certain policies of the United States, Vietnam, American support for Israel, and then American support for Arab autocrats who used to torture their own people. But only after 67, with the rise of, the Islamists, we began to see this dark image of the United States as the embodiment of evil in the world. And I mean, we were schizophrenic about America. I mean, I remember at one time going to see a movie, The Green Beret by John Wayne, I guess, if you remember it, you know. It was about Vietnam, obviously. I was against the war in Vietnam, but hey, John Wayne. So we went to see John Wayne's movie. When we left the theater, there was a demonstration across the street against the war in Vietnam and against the movie. So what did we do? We went and joined them. And but we, so it was essentially political. It was not cultural. After 67, the rise of the Islamists, and the gradual pulverization of Arab society by these by the Islamists and by the ruling dictators. The Islamists began to speak in absolutist terms. These are true believers. These are not the long ones. These are organized. They are the true believers. And we began to see the echoes of Sayyid Qutb, who lived in the United States for 2 years, and he saw nothing but hedonism and materialism and whatnot. So if you compare Beirut and Alexandria in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, even 70s, with now, I refer to Beirut now because of Hezbollah's incredible influence, which is political and cultural. You would think that they are trying to turn Beirut into a Tehran on the Mediterranean. If you go to Alexandria, which was a diverse city most of the last century until the 1950s, Greeks, Italians, Jews, Christians, Arabs, you name it. Now it's a hotbed for the radical Islamists. And so the rise of these new ideologies on the rubbles of the previous defeated ones is what is shaping the political discourse today in the Arab world. And when you look at why ISIS is controlling large swath in two countries, Iraq and Syria, you have to admit that the state in Iraq and Syria was a failed state. No representative institutions, incredible repression, and the lack of legitimacy. In fact, you know what I tried to say earlier, one of the biggest problems in Muslim history is the issue of political legitimacy. We are still struggling with political legitimacy. In the 1960s and 70s in Europe, you had the phenomena of the Red Brigades and Bader-Meinhof, whatever. They created havoc in society, but then they were defeated. Their culture was defeated because you had strong states in the real sense. You had good governance. You had representative governance. You had other options. We don't have that in the Arab world. And I hate to sound like a Cassandra, but for the next generation or two and maybe more, the Arab world will continue to unravel. And the United States will be forced again to go back and send expeditionary forces, whether they like it or not. And unless the Arabs themselves reform their own societies, and they have done that before, and they've done that in the past, but unless they do that, and only they can do that, the United States can help, the West can help, but the main responsibility is for the Arabs to own their problem. But you cannot own your problem unless you start by admitting that you contributed to this problem. We had half decent states when the monarchy was in Iraq or in Egypt. Look at Egypt now; it is intolerant. It is falling apart. In my youth, we used to look up to Egypt because it was a tolerant society. It was the place that produced great cinema and literature, and it was tolerant. There were no political violence. Political violence was the exception. Political violence was the exception, unlike the other states like Iraq and Syria and whatnot. But even Egypt now, as a state, 7,000-year history, is crumbling. And I don't see the intellectual vibrancy. You see once in a while great artists here and there, but there is no movement. There is nothing. and the Muslim reformers are orphans because they don't have a single institution. Al-Azhar is useless. There is no political movement that could bring them together to create really a mass desire for change. There are intellectuals, and the good ones are in jail or in Europe. One final thing. There was two events in Cairo, and I talk about Egypt because Egypt is a very important country. More than 20 years ago, an Islamist reformer by the name of Nasser Hamid Abu Zayd produced incredible work. He came up with a new hermeneutics about Islam, a new interpretation of the Quran, a very intelligent man. The Islamists went berserk, and they want to, and they demonized him, and they want to put in jail, and they pronounced him as an apostate. If somebody establishes in the Muslim world that you are an apostate, they can kill you. They can kill you. And an apostate cannot be married to a Muslim woman. So they wanted him to be divorced. The great Egyptian state under our friend Mubarak could not protect this man who was forced to flee his own country and seek refuge in Copenhagen. That to me was anecdotal point that shows the decline and the beginning of the unraveling of that society. The other cultural event was the stabbing of Najib Mahfouz, who was our Charles Dickens, who was our Dostoevsky. He was in his 80s by these two radical Islamists. That to me was the beginning, the death of what was left of liberalism in Egypt. Unless the Arabs and the Muslims, I talk about the Arabs, I know the Arabs, I'm one of them. Unless they own the problem, they're not going to fix it. But even if they own it today, they're not going to fix it in my lifetime. That's why I'm very pessimistic.
Thank you very much. I'm actually going to follow up by a question we actually had was how do you explain basically what produces basically the rise of the Mahdi's and kind of outline some of it in doing authoritarianism and also this change in cultural values potentially. But I'm going to move to this question. We have this young gentleman waiting for us.
My name is Fahed Abu Akil. I'm a retired Presbyterian minister, so when you are retired, you can be blunt. I don't understand how a dictator like Saddam can control the country and no Qaeda, no Daesh, and when the superpower of the world comes, they go all over creation. Question one. Question two, there are three elephants in the room that nobody wants to touch about. One is the superpower of the world, the USA, is married to Saudi Arabia, a one-family deal, and to me, they are the cause of extremism, number one, through Wahhabism. Number two is there's no way for Daesh to continue going without the support of Saudi Arabia, the Gulf, and Turkey. And the third elephant, it will be the state of Israel occupying the Palestinian for 49 years, and no one want to touch these elephants.
I'm an elephant toucher, no problem. I'll touch the elephant anywhere.
I think you can go to jail for elephant touching in some
I'll
places.
Touch the
be
elephant.
Careful.
My husband's not in the room. I'll touch the elephant anywhere. Okay, so first with the Iraq, I had the great pleasure of being a student of Hanna Batatu, who was a great scholar on Iraq. And if you look at the layers of Mukhabarat and the Durut, the pressure, the Secret Service, the police services, everybody was informing on everyone. Phoebe Marr used to like to joke that even the trees in the park were bugged. The only reason that Saddam was able to control the population, first of all, he had an inner circle of Takritis that were all relatives. And so you had the dominance of the minority Sunni over the majority Shia, but only because he could offer some selective buy-in, but the amount of pressure, people who would disappear, people who were tortured, and so this is where I'm going to gently disagree with you, I don't think that these regimes were as wonderful as maybe the 1950s in our hindsight. We see them. Yes, they might have been liberal on one hand, but they were very coercive. And I think that the coerciveness of these regimes probably helped support the creation of many of the problems we see now. Like, for example, Wahhabism. I think that I made myself very unpopular on Saudi in an interview about four weeks ago, where I said that Saudi has beheaded more people than ISIS. And in fact, ISIS was using, until they created their own textbooks, with, I think Jacob Olidort has just produced a pamphlet or a research on all of the textbooks ISIS is using. The vast majority of the curriculum was Saudi curriculum, and there's a reason for that. Because it is a very limited, it is not liberal at all, it hates Shia as much as it hates Israel, and so this is absolutely part of the problem. Part of the problem that nobody wants to face is because, you know, there is issues of oil, finance, economics, debt, relations with the Arab world. And so on the one hand, in order to have partners in the Middle East, occasionally the United States has to get into bed with some people who are not particularly democratic and liberal. And the alternative is either involvement or this idea that you're going to do offshore balancing, you're going to stay and be an isolationist. And these two options are not great. The last two questions very quickly about Daesh. Daesh has been able to finance itself relatively independently because it emptied the banks in Mosul. It's engaged in drug trade. It's engaged in illegal antiquities trade. And then, of course, kidnapping. And as a result...
And oil smuggling.
Sorry, I forgot about that. And so as a result, it's had access to great resources. I don't know whether the Saudis are actually giving money to Daesh or whether that is no longer the case or whether they've chosen Jabhat al-Nusra, now FFS. But the last point about the occupation, it's important. Daesh right now, what we see on the platforms and Telegram and in the chat rooms, they're making a huge play for the Palestinians, and they're complaining that Palestinians don't participate. And I think perhaps one of the reasons is that Daesh doesn't recognize a unique Palestine because it didn't exist at the time of the Prophet. And so the idea of a Palestinian identity where Palestinians are very attached to a particular piece of geography doesn't mesh with Daesh. In fact, Daesh recognizes Palestine about as much as Bibi Netanyahu does, which is zero. And so as a result, I think we have to make the separation that Palestinians are not participating in Daesh, but people will tell you in this room, there was terrorism before 1967. There was terrorism before Israel occupied parts of the West Bank and the Jolan and Gaza. But the fact remains is that these are all issues that ISIS wants us to interconnect so that they're impossible to resolve. But in fact, they may exist independently. Thank you so much for your question.
Just quickly, I was comparing the monarchies in Iraq and in Egypt between the two world wars, where you had a more tolerant, liberal polity.
Farouk wasn't great to his people.
He did not kill people as Nasser did. And the monarchy in Iraq did not commit the massacres that Saddam did commit. There is a qualitative difference between the nature of governance under those monarchies between the two world wars in Iraq and in Egypt. And I stand by that. And I think
we'll have to agree to disagree.
No, you have to show me. You can't. The other thing is about American support for Arab autocrats. And by autocrats, I mean both the monarchies and the military men that really pulverized the Arab world. There was a time when the United States, there was an incredible reservoir of goodwill towards the United States in the 19th century and until the mid-50s, until actually 1967. The United States was not was the only great Western country that did not colonize Muslims and Arabs, unlike the French and the Brits and the Belgians and the Portuguese and the Spaniards. That's very important. And the United States was seen as the educator, AUB in Lebanon, AUC in Cairo, and whatnot. The United States opened up its gates, so to speak, to immigrants from Lebanon, Syria, and Palestine in the mid-19th century, and you can see them. You can see their grandchildren, you know, prospering in this country. Things began to change. Actually, in 1956, Eisenhower was a popular leader. John F. Kennedy was lionized in Algeria because he supported the Algerian struggle for independence from the French. Algeria in the 1960s. Things began to go south after 67. and when the United States was seen as not only supporting Israel, but supporting Israel's conquests. It's very important. And then the American support for the autocrats. That's really the source of a great deal of resentment and anger. The United States looked the other way when regimes were even engaging in even mass killings. And I used to blame the United States and the Arab states and Europe and the Soviet Union for supporting Saddam during the war with Iraq, with Iran, when he used chemical weapons, when he butchered his own people. And the same thing with even some of the monarchies. So the United States, when it goes to the Middle East, it has to be cognizant of this. There is a legacy now. And all of us now complain about the Sunni Shia bloodletting. And it is new, relatively. Things were not like that throughout Muslim history. But the American invasion of Iraq in 2003 took the lid off. It was Saddam who began this anti-Shia views in the Arab world when he invaded Iran and he used pejorative terms
to cut you off.
Yeah, but I think you know, we have to be cognizant of the fact that we as Americans are somewhat responsible for the unraveling of the Middle East because of Iraq and because of Libya too.
Sorry to cut you off. We're about 15 minutes over time. Thanks very much, our panelists. I'll call you back in about 10 minutes. 10 minutes back here.